You may have heard the term object-oriented programming and wondered what it meant. There are some more technical definitions of object-oriented programming that we will get into later. Like I said before, half of what we do as programmers is to model information as data in virtual systems. In OOP languages, our goal is to group information, such as primitives, together as objects, and we can even add functionality or other objects within these objects. Let us take a look at some examples to expand this idea. Now that I have shown you some basics of the language, I am more and more going to teach you things using direct examples from the demo Sudoku application. If you are not already familiar with Sudoku, you will probably want to pause this video here and spend a few minutes learning the basics. The rules and structure of the game are very easy, which is one of the reasons I chose it as a demo. In keeping with what I just said before, our first task will be to model a Sudoku puzzle as a virtual object. We can do this by using a class, which is a special data structure. If you're working in a real IDE, then you will want to open up or create a new project, as I will ask you to create files. If you are using an online browser, just start with an empty editor. As you can see, we already have a basic class declaration here, which includes an access modifier, public, which we will discuss later, and the name of our class, which corresponds to the file name. Now, it is important to understand that I figured out the structure of this class ahead of time using techniques that I will teach you in part 5. Anyways, I decided that there are two data structures which are necessary to virtually represent a Sudoku game as a virtual object. The first was the actual puzzle itself, which I decided to model as a two-dimensional 9x9 array. For now, ignore the private keyword. I will explain access modifiers in due time. Now, the other thing I decided is that we want some kind of way to represent what state the game is currently in. I decided that three potential states might be useful: new game, active game, and a complete game. Here's a question for you, and this time there is not really a specific right answer. How would you represent these different states? Pause the video and think about it for a second. Some of you may have decided that you could represent the different states using integer values, maybe 1 for new game, 2 for active game, 3 for complete game. Some of you may have decided that using strings could also work, since you could actually write out each state in a very legible way. Whatever approach you thought of, they all have different benefits and drawbacks which must be considered. Since this is a very small application, and I know memory consumption will not be much of a problem, I decided to use a data structure called an enum. As you can see, it looks a lot like a class. Let's add some entries to this enum. Now that we have built it, let me explain what an enum is. An enum allows us to create a restricted set of constant values in a very legible way. The important thing here is that we have a situation where we know that an object will be in one of three states, and we know what all of those potential states are, and we do not expect them to change much. Now, enums are not the most memory efficient tool for the job, but the benefit of them is increased legibility, and we will see later on that they can make it easier to read and control the flow of our programs. In a previous lesson, I said that there are two types of variables, primitive and reference, but also that there are other types. A variable, which sits in the body of a class, is referred to as a member variable. It is a member of that class. At the moment, I have not initialized or created these two variables. The most common way to do that is to use a constructor method. The simplest way to create a constructor is to type the name of a class followed by parentheses and curly brackets. Note that to create a proper constructor, the name of it must match the name of the class exactly. Now, we can also include an optional access modifier, and 95% of the time you will want that modifier to be public. Again, I will talk about those more later. Sometimes we want this class to be given the values we will assign to our member variables, and sometimes we want to create those values from within our constructor. In this case, I want the values for game state and grid state to come from an external source. These two variables here are what we call parameter variables. They exist only as long as the program is executing that particular method. Basically, what we want to do here is use these parameter variables as temporary containers for values which we will assign to our member variables. Now, I can actually give these variables whatever name I like, but by convention, we usually give them the same name as the member variables we will be assigning their values to. Now, this presents a problem because if they have the same name, the compiler will not know that I want to assign the values to my member variables. To fix this problem, we can use the this keyword, which will tell the compiler when we are referring to this class, a member of this class. We've already seen some different access modifiers, public and private, and also seen that they can precede variables, classes, enums, and methods like our constructor. The rules behind these access modifiers are pretty simple, but it is important that you understand the motivation behind them. As I said before, in OOP, one of our goals is to group related pieces of information together in objects, and we have seen that classes are a way in which we build and design such objects. If we pretend for a moment that each of us is a human object, it makes sense that we want to have restrictions on what kind of information we share with each other. Some things we keep private, some things we share with a limited number of people or organizations, and some we make available publicly. Now, there are two reasons why we should decide not to share something. Firstly, some information about us, if we share it publicly, could be used by malicious individuals or organizations to harm us financially or otherwise. Secondly, it might also be the case that some information simply does not serve any purpose to share publicly. In fact, it might be a little bit detrimental. This is not just true about information we can think of as variables, but also behaviors which we can think of as methods like our constructor. To return to Java, there are four different access modifiers. Public is accessible by any software entity which is capable of pointing or referencing to that particular source in virtual memory. Usually this will be other objects from within the same application. But it is also possible in certain circumstances that it could even be an external application. Protected, aka package private, is accessible within any software entity that is within the same package, class, or subclass. Not including an access modifier defaults to visibility within the same package and class, but not within subclasses. Private, the most restrictive type, only allows information and behavior to be visible within the body of the class itself. The general rule for access modifiers is that you should always use the most restrictive modifier possible that still allows your program to function properly. In Java, by convention, we always make member variables private. The reason for this can be summarized by the following principle. An object should always have control over how external software entities access and change its member variables. With that being said, this class would be pretty much useless if we had no way of getting information in and out of it. To solve this problem, we use what are called accessor methods, also known as getters and setters. We can make the method public so that any software entity can access it. If we wanted to, we could include some kind of access restriction or check which an external entity would have to pass in order to get a hold of this data, but it is not necessary here. You will spend a lot of time writing these sorts of accessor methods, and any half-decent IDE will include a way to generate them for you. After clicking inside the body of this class in IntelliJ IDEA, I'm going to hit Alt-Enter. I'm going to select Getter and Setter, but also note that you can auto-generate a constructor, which is another option I use frequently. I then select the appropriate member variables for which I want to generate my accessors and then hit OK. There you have it.